My friend Riley was the type who loved urban legends, horror movies, and anything that gave her a thrill. So, when she found out about the elevator game, a supposed ritual to visit another world, she was immediately obsessed. I shrugged it off as another one of her spooky obsessions, the kind she'd eventually get bored of. But Riley was different this time. She was dead set on playing it, and, naturally, she wanted me to come along. "You really believe this?" I asked her when she first mentioned it. Riley just grinned, that mischievous spark in her eye. "Don't you want to know what happens? Aren't you even a little curious?" I wasn't, really, but her excitement was contagious, and by the end of the conversation, she'd somehow convinced me to go along with it. The rules of the game were simple but specific. You needed a building with at least 10 floors and an elevator that wouldn't be interrupted by other people entering. You entered a certain sequence of floors in a specific order, and, supposedly, when you reached the 10th floor, a doorway to another world would open. It sounded ridiculous, but Riley was convinced. We agreed to meet up on a Friday night and head to an old office building downtown that she scoped out. It was mostly abandoned and rarely used, which made it the perfect spot. I brought a flashlight just in case and a thermos of coffee to get us through what I expected would be a very dull night. When we arrived, the building was as empty as she'd said it would be. The lobby lights were dim, casting long shadows across the marble floors. The place smelled stale, like dust and cold metal. The air felt thick, almost like the building was holding its breath, waiting. "You ready?" Riley asked, her eyes wide with excitement. "Let's just get this over with," I muttered. We stepped into the elevator, and Riley pressed the button for the 4th floor, the starting point of the sequence. From there, she began the ritual, moving from the 4th floor to the 2nd, to the 6th, and so on. I tried not to laugh as she punched each button with a dramatic flourish. As we reached the final floor, the elevator stopped, and I prepared to step out, expecting nothing but an empty hallway. But Riley grabbed my arm. "No, this is it, the final step." She pressed the button for the 10th floor. The elevator shuddered slightly and then began its ascent. I rolled my eyes, fully expecting this to end like every other ghost story Riley had dragged me into, anticlimactically. But as the elevator climbed, the temperature seemed to drop. By the time we passed the 7th floor, I could see my breath fogging the air. Did the AC just kick on?" I asked, feeling uneasy. Riley just looked at me, her face pale. For once, she wasn't smiling. The elevator stopped at the 10th floor, and for a second, everything was silent. Then, with a soft chime, the doors slid open. Beyond the elevator doors was the hallway. At first glance, it looked the same as the lobby, a long corridor with faded carpet and peeling paint. But there was something off. The light fixtures overhead flickered dimly, casting shadows that seemed to writhe along the walls. The air smelled musty, like old books and something faintly metallic, almost like blood. "This is it," Riley whispered. Her voice sounded far away. She stepped out of the elevator, her movements slow, almost dreamlike. I hesitated, every instinct telling me to stay inside, to let the doors close and take me back to the familiar, safe first floor. But I couldn't leave her, so I followed her out, the elevator doors sliding shut behind us with a faint hiss. The hallway stretched out before us, impossibly long, much longer than it had looked from inside the elevator. As we walked, I noticed that each door we pressed had no numbers, no labels, just blank doors with tarnished handles. We stopped in front of one of them, and Riley reached out to touch the doorknob. I grabbed her arm, stopping her. "Riley, we should go back. This doesn't feel right." She looked at me, her face pale, her eyes wide. "Don't you feel it? This is real, Sam. This place isn't normal." I shivered, feeling an icy chill seep into my bones. She was right. Everything about this place felt wrong, like it was hollowed out, waiting. And in the silence, I could hear something. A faint, distant hum, like machinery far below us, turning and grinding. "Let's just go back," I said, trying to pull her away. But Riley shook me off. She was fixated on the door, her hand reaching for the handle. Before I could stop her, she opened it. Inside the room was darkness, just an endless black void that seemed to swallow up the light from the hallway. Riley took a step forward, peering inside, and I could see the strange fascination on her face. "Riley, don't..." I started, but it was too late. She stepped into the room. The moment her foot crossed the threshold, the door slammed shut with a deafening bang. I lunged forward, grabbing the handle, but it wouldn't budge. I pounded the door, shouting her name, panic crawling at my throat. "Riley! Riley, open the door!" There was no answer, just the silence, thick and heavy. Desperately, I scanned the hallway, looking for any other way to find her, to get her back. But every door was locked, every handle cold and unyielding. I ran back to the elevator and pounded the call button, praying it would come, that I could get help. After what felt like an eternity, the doors slid open. I jumped inside, slamming my hand against the button for the first floor, my heart racing. As the elevator doors began to close, I glanced back down the hallway. Riley was standing there, at the end of the corridor, staring at me. Her face was pale, her eyes wide and unblinking. Her mouth hung open, her expression frozen in terror. She didn't move, she just watched me, her gaze hollow and empty. "Riley?" I whispered, my voice trembling. The doors slid shut, cutting her off from view, and the elevator began its descent. I returned to the lobby, sprinting outside to call the police. I told them about the abandoned building, about Riley disappearing, and about the strange door. They arrived quickly, bringing in backup and even firefighters, prepared to search every floor. But when we returned to the 10th floor, it was just a normal hallway. The endless corridor was gone, replaced by a short, dingy stretch of carpeting with numbered doors that led to empty rooms. There was no sign of Riley, no sign of the door she had gone through. The police searched every inch of the building, but it was as if she'd vanished into thin air. Months passed, and I did everything I could to find Riley. I contacted the police, psychics, paranormal investigators, anyone who might be able to help. But there was no sign of her, and no one could explain what had happened. Most people stopped believing me, assuming Riley had just left town without saying goodbye. But I knew what I saw. Then, about 6 months later, I got a call in the middle of the night. Half asleep, I answered, and all I heard was static. But in between the crackling, I could make out faint whispers, two words over and over. "Come back." I hung up, my heart pounding. I tried to tell myself it was a wrong number, a glitch. But the calls just kept coming, sometimes in the dead of night, sometimes just as I was about to fall asleep. The static, the whispers, that same message. Then, one night, as I lay in bed, my phone rang again. I let it ring, but the whispers started, louder this time, insistent. Against my better judgment, I picked it up. "I'm still here." The call cut off, leaving me in silence. Now, every time I close my eyes, I see her face in the darkness, her hollow eyes staring back at me. And sometimes, when I walk past an elevator, I swear I hear that faint, rhythmic hum behind the doors. It's waiting, just like she is, for the next time I press the button.